Okay, I will call the regular meeting to order at 7:18. Governing board meetings are held in the boardroom at the Ben Furlong Education Center located at 8700 South Kyrene Road in Tempe. We regularly meet on the second and fourth Tuesdays of the month. However, there is only one board meeting in July and usually December, although we plan to have two meetings in December this month, next month, next December, tomorrow. All meetings begin at 7 p.m. We welcome community involvement and encourage people to come to board meetings and be involved in our community. School board meetings are held in public to conduct the business of the district. These board meetings are broadcast on Tempe and Phoenix Cable Channel 99 Sundays between 6 to 8 a.m. and in Chandler on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at 6 p.m., Sunday at noon, and Tuesdays at 3. The Chandler broadcast will be aired the week following the board meeting. Tempe 11 on Cox Channel 11 now also airs our meetings three times a week on Tuesday evenings, Tuesday afternoons, and Sunday mornings. Specific times are available at their website. Videos of board meetings are posted on the Kyrene website approximately 1 week after the meeting. Board agendas may be obtained from the district office Kyrene website 24 hours in advance of each board meeting. Our superintendent, Dr. David Schauer, board secretary Marriott, senior leadership, lead principals, directors, and interested citizens are here with us tonight. The first item is a moment of silence. I'll ask you to please stand, and then Mrs. Sharma will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you, Mrs. Sharma. The next item is roll call. Will the board members please state their name for the record?
Ross Robb.
Bernadette Coggins.
Beth Brazel.
Ellen Sharma.
Michelle Hirsch. Let the record show all five board members are present. The next item is approval of the minutes. The first is approval of the minutes for the study session for October 25th. All governing board members may vote to approve these minutes. May I have a motion?
Move to approve.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Excuse me. Next item is approval of the minutes for the regular meeting of October 25th. All board members, with the exception of Ms. Brazel, may vote to approve these minutes. May I have a motion?
I make a motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Let the record show 4-0 pass. Next is approval of the minutes for the executive session for November 8th. All governing board members may vote to approve these minutes. May I have a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next is approval of the regular meeting minutes of November 8th. All board members may vote to approve these minutes. May I have a motion?
I make a motion to approve the minutes from the November 8th.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next is to approve tonight's agenda. Are there any changes to this evening's agenda, including the consent agenda? Then may I have a motion to approve tonight's agenda?
Move to approve tonight's agenda.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. We're at item 5.0, which is request to speak to the governing board. The 5.0 section is for items not listed on the agenda. Because 5.0 items are not on the agenda, the board is not able to respond to comments made during this section. When a request to speak is made, please note that you're addressing the governing board only. If you wish to speak to the governing board, please fill out one of the blue cards located on the table by the door and bring it to our board secretary, Marriott. One blue card per agenda item, please. I do have five blue cards here. I'd like to remind you that out of respect for audience members, the time is limited for 3 minutes up to 10 speakers before the regular business portion of the meeting, with the balance after the business portion if there are more cards than that. The first speaker request is Danielle Lowe.
This is the first time I've been here, so hi guys. My name is Danielle Lowe. I am a mother of four children, three of whom attend Kyrene schools, two at Esperanza, one at Centennial. I have another little guy who's going to be entering kindergarten next year. And I am not here necessarily to talk about my own full-day kindergarten needs for my son, because luckily we're blessed enough to be able to afford to pay for a full-day kindergarten. My concern is more for those that are unable to pay for the kindergarten, full-day kindergarten, as well as my concern for Kyrene overall and budgetary concerns going forward. I'm a speech-language pathologist in charter schools, and I see the draw from free kindergarten programs, full-day kindergarten programs that I work at in the schools, and I see people jumping ship from the local public schools to get that free day advantage, essentially for whatever working parents or people who feel that they very much would like to have a full-day program. And so my concern is that there's such a pull from those charter schools that ultimately down the road you're not going to have the people coming back in first grade, and it could ultimately be a terrible budget crisis for Kyrene down the road, that you're just going to get a lot of kids just dropping off the rolls. On top of the fact that we kind of need to look at the fact that Kyrene, when I first moved into the Kyrene School District about 12, 13 years ago, it was pretty much a district at that point of a haves, a lot of people with lots of ability for money and lots of, and as home prices went up and up and up. And now I don't feel like that represents our community anymore. And so my concern is overall that there might be both a concern for those that are unable to pay for the full-day kindergarten. And again, with that, just kind of that trickle down of them pulling to charter schools with the free all-day programs, and that ultimately down the road it'll be bad for Kyrene overall. So you might save up front, but down the road it'll probably not be a very good thing. So thank you.
Thank you.
Next is Nancy Branch.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, and audience members. Usually when I speak before the board, I bring a piece of paper up here so I don't miss all of my points. But tonight when I came in, I didn't plan on speaking. But after sitting through the board study session, I just felt this need to get up. At the start of the school year, our staff really focused on celebrating strengths. And we worked on identifying all of our strengths. And I learned that one of my top five strengths is gratitude. And so tonight what I want to do is just use that strength, because gratitude is about thanking those for what they have done. And that means a lot to you. So I'm up here tonight just to express gratitude. And I want to begin with the board members that I'm facing right now. And just thank you so much. As community members coming forth and just giving of your time to make very difficult decisions. And thank you so much for putting the needs of students first and foremost as you make those difficult decisions. I can't begin to imagine the free hours of time that you invest, and I thank you on behalf of our entire community. Next, I'd like to thank Dr. Schauer, who has been nothing but an amazing mentor to me since I came on board as a leader in Kyrene. And I thank you so much for the leadership that you give and for your deep caring for students and for all of the employees here in Kyrene and the community. So thank you so much. The list could go on, and I look around this room, and I look on this side, and I look on this side, and I look behind me, and I see people who have just touched my life in such a way and has helped me to grow as a person and a leader, and they have become family and friends who will be friends for life and will have impacted me. But what I know about them is that each of them are here about the work for children and care so deeply. And I appreciate our families who choose Kyrene. I appreciate so much our taxpayers who went out there and voted to support us with our technology. And I just am thankful for so many things. The amazing resources that we have available to us compared to other school districts is phenomenal, and each and every day I give thanks that I have the opportunity to work in Kyrene, that I come to school every day so thankful that, number one, I have a job when so many other people do not at this place and time, that I have a job that I love to come to because I have amazing staff members who care so much for children, work so hard on their behalf, and we have families who just give everything they can to make Kyrene the best. I know I've forgotten so many people that I'm thankful for, but I just want people in this room, including my old millennial folks back there, to know how much I care, how thankful I am for you, and just wanted to share that. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
I know we're not supposed to respond, so pretend that I'm not saying that it's nice to be thanked. Next is Carrie Brown.
Good evening, Madam President, members of the board, and I'll go ahead and say Dr. Schauer, district staff, and community. My name is Carrie Brown. I'm a parent of two children at Kyrene de las Lomas. I ask that as you make your difficult decision on funding full-day kindergarten, that you carefully consider what the new half-day kindergarten program will look like and the possible effects it will have on our school communities. If full-day kindergarten is not tuition-free, the half-day model will be the program available to all Kyrene kindergartners. It will likely be the most common program at my children's school, Lomas. If the district does not fund full-day kindergarten, will the half-day program be equal to the tuition-based model? I don't see how this would be possible if our students must meet the new Common Core standards. 2 years ago, when I considered many kindergarten programs throughout the Valley, it was very clear to me that I didn't want a half-day program for my son in kindergarten. Half-day kindergarten programs in most public schools tend to be inappropriately focused on meeting reading, writing, and math standards. There is no time for experiential learning or even free play. Let's not forget that more standards for kindergarten are coming. Current early childhood education research suggests that one of the most important parts of any developmentally appropriate kindergarten program is the opportunity for children to play. Children learn important social skills through playing. They were made to play. Taking play away in favor of focusing on academic skills in kindergarten is not good for any child. Young children in kindergarten are often quite capable of meeting the new rigorous academic standards. In fact, I welcome a lot of them. But they still need to play. They still need to explore the world using their hands and bodies and voices as they can when they are able to have specials. Will new half-day Kyrene kindergarten programs be able to provide children with specials? I still recall how refreshing it was when I attended orientation for kindergarten in a Kyrene school, and I was shown the art room and the music room. We still need to provide our kindergartners with opportunities to paint and make music. They need time to run around and be silly with each other. They need a break from direct instruction and practice drills for Dibbles assessments. These opportunities are already few and far between in the current full-day program, but they are still there. We cannot assume that all future Kyrene students are in quality preschool programs. Kindergarten has become very important to make sure that our students gain social and developmental skills and academic skills necessary to succeed in school. Tuition-free full-day kindergarten is the best way to ensure that our students and teachers are able to meet the standards set for them by the state. Kyrene teachers are also being held accountable for their students' academic outcomes. We owe it to our students, their families, our teachers, and our school communities to continue to provide tuition-free full-day kindergarten. That said, I understand that it's a hard decision. I thank you for your consideration, and good luck with the challenges ahead.
Anne Ellsworth.
Good evening, my name is Anne Ellsworth. My child attends Kyrene Del Norte in Tempe. And I am here tonight to express my concern regarding the fee-based option for all-day kindergarten. I have four concerns that I'd like to address tonight. I am concerned that Norte will not have a high enough demand for a full-day tuition-based kindergarten class. If there is not enough demand at Norte, will I be forced to travel out of my neighborhood for the all-day program? We have a child who will be in kindergarten in 2 years, and so we may potentially have one child at Norte and another somewhere else if we want him in full-day kindergarten. Second, moving families out of their neighborhood school boundary has long-lasting consequences for the diversity of the school and the health of the neighborhood. If everyone who can pay for the full-day program is forced to move out of their neighborhood school, who is left at the school? Only those who have no other choice. I resent deeply the notion that I may have to drive past my neighborhood school that I love dearly after only one semester in order to place my child in a full-day kindergarten program. I ask the school board to please make a decision that adds to neighborhood cohesion rather than detracts from it. Second, if a school is able to offer both the full and half-day kindergarten class, what does first grade look like at that school? Particularly in schools where the majority of first graders are students whose parents could not afford the full-day option. For the child who was placed in the full-day option, how will their learning experience be compromised by the number of students in that first grade class for whom this is their first experience of a full-day program? How will the teacher be equipped to handle essentially two separate groups of learners? Those who benefited from the full-day program and those who were deprived of that option due to their inability to pay. This brings me to my third concern, which is that it seems to me that the school board is suggesting that the notion of an essentially separate kindergarten program for those who can pay from those who cannot is still equal. The assumption of equality is based on the fact that children who attend the half-day program will be assessed by the same state standards as children who participate in the full-day program. I am not a legal scholar, but I do wonder if this option is even legal, because it sounds like a lot but separate, it sounds like a lot but as separate but equal to me. Finally, we, the families of the Kyrene School District, are all in this state budget crisis together. The school board must find a way to make budget cuts that we all feel. Not cuts that are primarily and most severely felt by low-income schools and families. At our school, Kyrene Del Norte, and at other low SES schools, the option to move to a fee-based kindergarten program will be deeply disruptive to our neighborhood and our school community. A tuition-based full-day kindergarten will cut us to the bone. The school board, I ask you to please approve an option in which the burden of this budget crisis is shared as equally as possible by all schools in the Kyrene District.
Thank you.
Thank you for your service to our community. It is appreciated.
Joanne Chalais. I'm sorry if I pronounced that wrong. I think I said that last time.
Actually a big debate in my husband's hometown about how to pronounce it, so you're not alone. Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, staff, members of the community. My name is Joanne Chalais. My children attend Kyrene Del Norte. I have two boys, one in third grade and one currently in kindergarten. And as parents, it's our nature, I think, to want what's best for our own kids. As elected leaders, you are tasked with a Herculean effort of trying to go beyond that and to consider what's best for the entire community. I'm trying to take off my hat of being a parent and think about what is best. Sorry, I'm trying to take off my parent hat of what is best for my kids, and I'm trying to imagine what a fee-based full-day kindergarten program would look like and what it means to our school communities. We know that inequities exist all around us. That's somewhat inevitable. But to blatantly place them side by side in our schools, I think, is irresponsible at best. How does that look at a day-to-day level? You kids go here, you get half. You kids go here, you get a whole, because your family can pay. No school in our district will be immune from this daily routine. Every elementary school in our district, there will be a clear and daily separation of the haves and the have-nots right before our eyes, right before our children's eyes. There will be a fracturing of the kindergarten cohort at school that then spills into the first grade and into the larger community. This isn't the culture of the Kyrene School District that I've known, and I don't think it's the direction we want to go. The fee-based option is already fracturing the involved parent community, at a time when we should be standing together so our voices can be heard, that our schools should be better funded to find new revenue sources so our kids can have the opportunities that we want for them. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Next is item 6.01, the Positive Behavior Intervention and Support presentation. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you. I'm happy to welcome Sherry Dukes, who is our Director of Exceptional Student Services, to lead this. And this is something that you had asked for, a presentation about this program. And it's a great program, and we're excited about it. So happy to welcome you, Sherry, to the podium.
Mark has given me instructions on the clicker. So, Madam President, Governing Boards, Dr. Schauer, and community members, it's a pleasure to talk with you tonight about positive behavior intervention and supports, known as PBIS. PBIS is one of our district initiatives that started in June 2010 when the board approved a task force recommendations on safe schools and crisis management. As part of that recommendation, it was to provide a systematic way of addressing behavior in the same way that we address academics through core instruction and tiered interventions. We are really fortunate that we had six schools go through training last year, three elementary schools, three middle schools, learning about PBIS. This is one of the few educational initiatives where you actually have a year of training before you do implementation. So I think we were really pleased to be able to do that. Each year we plan on having six schools go through a training, learning about the essential components of PBIS, and then the following year implementing PBIS, as well as learning more of those intense strategies, supplemental and intense strategies, for some of our students. One thing I'm really proud about is our behavior intervention teacher specialists, who are finally known as the BITS. And the BITS will be presenting tonight. They're a fabulous group of individuals that really do an incredible job across the district supporting all students regarding to behavior, which ultimately impacts student achievement. So with that, further ado, I would like to introduce one of our first bits, Lisa Roberts.
Okay. Good evening. When we're talking about PBIS and positive behavior supports, the key to the whole concept and framework and system is that it goes hand in hand with academics. So we can't separate the behavior from the academics. And this triangle is very familiar to a lot of people. The green part, which is our largest section, about 80% of the triangle for academics and behavior, those are universal interventions, and that's for all students. The next part of the triangle, which is about 5 to 10%, those are for our targeted group. Those are the kids that need a little bit more, whether it's for reading, writing, math, or behavior. They need just a little bit more. The top section, which is the, you know, about 1% or so, they're the intensive group. They need individual supports. Hang on. There we go. So what is PBIS? It is a framework and it is a system. And under that umbrella falls several things. The key, the most important thing, is to teach the expectations. We can't assume that children come to school and know how to behave. We don't assume that they come to school knowing how to read, write, or do math. Same with behavior. So the premise is to teach the expectations. We then reinforce those when we are seeing those expectations, not just in the students, but also with the staff. And then we make the data-driven decisions to figure out where we need to focus. So why should we implement it? There's at least 30 years of research showing the positive effects of what positive behavior interventions and supports do in schools and for children. So that's one of the biggest reasons, because it's research-based. It also shows an increase in student academic achievement. Increased morale at school, not just for the students, but also for staff. Safer schools, less bullying, a decrease in the discipline referrals, and also missed instructional time. So if students are in classes more because their behavior is where it needs to be, They're going to learn more. Hang on. There we go. And now I'd like to introduce another bit, Lizzie Fortune.
The expectation of the clicker. So some of the essential features of PBIS are 3 to 5 positively stated school-wide expectations. Based on those expectations, we're going to recognize students' positive behaviors that they're displaying throughout the day, and as well as staff's behavior, positive behavior that they're displaying as well. And then we're going to use the data to plan for proactive strategies in order to positively reinforce the behavior that we'd like to see. This is an example of some of the expectations. This is Pueblo School. So their 3 to 5 positively stated school-wide expectations are to be respectful, be responsible, and be safe. And that is the best bulldog behavior. We also have Anna Bailey and Hunter Rujo from Altadena who will share some of the things that they've been doing as well.
Good evening. Whoa, that's loud. We feel very fortunate at Altadena to have students who already display positive behavior on a daily basis. Our goal with PBIS is for the students to now take what they already do to the next level, to go above and beyond simply following the school rules, to show their Panther pride in all that they do. Students in 6th through 8th grade consistently practice the expectations of the PRIDE acronym, positive choices, respect, integrity, determination, and excellence. When the PBIS committee created PRIDE, we chose expectations that we felt related to one another. For example, when a student volunteers to help a teacher clean up after the bell, they're making a positive choice as well as displaying excellence. When a student arrives on time to class, they're showing determination in their promptness as well as respecting the classroom environment. We are teaching our students what pride looks like in different areas of the school. For example, in the classroom, positive choices would be to turn in all work on time and to be quiet when others are talking. While in the lunch areas, the positive choices might look a little bit different. Students are expected to use good manners, including chewing with your mouth closed, use silverware and a napkin, etc., and staying within the designated boundaries. The expectations were rolled out one by one in order to not overwhelm the students with the new system that we were all so excited to implement. We began with pride in the classroom, followed by pride in the lunch areas and on the bus. Other areas that we will continue to focus on are showing pride in the media center, hallways, and believe it or not, our students actually show pride even in the bathroom. I have to admit that I was a little skeptical in the beginning that this was just another activity that we already busy teachers would have to squeeze into our routines. But PBIS is anything but an activity. It really is a way of life that makes both students and staff actually want to come to school each day. Instead of catching kids being bad, we catch them being good. The first week of school, I was about to hand out pride tickets to students who were working quietly in my very noisy sixth grade classroom. Immediately, a hush went through the crowd, and I heard a boy whisper, "Shh, here comes the teacher, and she's got those ticket things." Something that we are extremely proud of is that all staff, not just teachers, daily recognize students for going above and beyond. Many students have received pride tickets from their bus drivers, from cafeteria, and custodial staff, so it's great to have everybody on board. Ultimately, we expect that our students display pride outside of school and that the behaviors that are valued at school translate to their families and to their community. We are committed to making pride a part of every student's core foundation and moral character. For a student's perspective, I would like to introduce my wonderful and incredibly adorable nephew. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Hunter Rujo, and I am a sixth grader at Altadena. I feel proud of myself when I earn a pride ticket because my teacher always thanks me and tells me exactly what I did to earn it. They don't just give it to you and walk away. They explain what pride behavior you did. When they notice that I did something positive, it makes me want to do it the right thing even more. We all get really excited for the ticket exchange days too. That is when we can turn in our tickets to get rewards like getting to listen to our iPods or wearing our hat in the building. Every quarter, they also draw names, and certain kids get to go to a pride celebration. At the last celebration, there were snow cones, popcorn, and they even set up the Wii so students can play Just Dance. I earned my first pride ticket because I helped another student. He is just learning English, and I helped him understand the directions. I felt really good when my teacher noticed that I was being helpful, but I was even better that I was able to be there for one of my classmates. I'm going to keep showing my Panther pride at school with my family and in the community. Thank you.
Hunter. The governing board has a special thing that we give to students that come and speak at our board meetings. So this is our little positive token of thank you for coming. Good job. Thank you, Mrs. Sharma, for presenting that.
My name is Melody Freiberger. I'm another behavior intervention teacher with the district. Altadena did a beautiful job of explaining that expectations are given in each area of the school, from the bus in the morning all the way to the dismissal sidewalk in the afternoon. Classrooms, hallways, lunchrooms, everywhere has an expectation. So we know that being safe on the playground may look a little bit different than being safe in your classroom, and we want to make sure that all students have the same language, and all staff have the same language so that everyone knows what we're talking about. So now I'd like to invite Jim Verrill and his staff to come up, and they're going to present a little more on that.
I have Amy Odonez and Jocelyn Taylor. Jocelyn's a first grade teacher and Amy's a fourth grade teacher. To talk about teaching the expectations.
Good evening. What we are most excited about at Millennio is our use Thank of you. The common language, which you'll notice in our expectations at Millennio. We actually have a matrix that we have created that has every single area and all the different expectations, and we actually base it off of the character counts, so it's off of terrific. So showing trustworthiness, respect, responsibility, fairness, caring, and citizenship. So each of the different areas has, just like Altadena was saying, the specific components of what it's like to be trustworthy in that specific area. These are posted all around the school so that every teacher, staff member, student knows exactly what language we're using, so everyone feels safe and feels confident that they're going to be able to follow whatever the great job, Anna. Follow whatever the directions are and whatever the expectations are throughout the school and be successful.
I'm really loud, sorry. The first week of school, before teachers came back, we made videos. So the teachers had a chance to learn the expectations before teaching them to their students. And then we created something called a passport that I just handed out to you. In each area, there is the expectations at that place. So the kids would go to that area, and the teacher would read the expectations to them, and then they would go over good example and bad example, so the right way and the wrong way. And then when they would come back to the classroom, they would watch the expectation video that also showed the teachers doing the right way and the wrong way. The great thing about it was the kids loved watching their teachers do the wrong way, and then they were very good listeners when they saw the right way, even though they wanted to see the wrong way again. So we were able to reinforce the students using the specific wording on each expectation. So if we caught them doing something the right way, we could say, great job, Mrs. Ordonez, for being responsible and being on time to the meeting. So we are going to show you a video about the hallway expectations. Before we start that, we also sent a parent letter home that explained what our matrix was, matrix was, what PBIS is, and then we invited families to do it together at home. So they had all the character traits and what that would look like at the home so they could do their expectations for home as well. So here's our video.
Looks good to me. Yeah.
This is why the wrong way was much more exciting.
And how many of you walked down the hall like that?
So for each time we recognize students for doing what is expected and what we want them to do, we give them a sticker at Millennio, and they turn those stickers in the classroom. They fill out their name and their teacher's name, and they have classroom drawings for extra computer time or to go read to a younger buddy. We try to do things that add to academics, like being a mentor to somebody else or things that they can enjoy. And then each week they turn in all their tickets to the office. And so these are all of the tickets that we've collected over the course of the year. And so I think about this as each one of the positive things that have been spoken to our children, the positive reinforcement they have. And it makes me very proud every time I look in this bucket and see how many times our children have been recognized for being on time, doing their best, and following what our expectations at school.
I'm not really a betting person, but I'm betting Mr. Robb's name is not in there.
I'm Anita Holm, and I'm another one of the behavior intervention teachers in our district. So Millennio did a good job of explaining the positive reinforcement system that many of the schools use. Up on the screen is just a few of the different types of reinforcements. The next few slides are some pictures from some of our schools of different things. Apprende, the students earn wristbands, and with that wristband earns them different privileges. They also collect positive, they track the number of positives in their office area, you can see in the middle picture, and they keep track of that. And on the other picture, there is, it just states what their expectations are, and they are P plus R squared, pride plus responsibility and respect. Niños. They are also using the Terrific logo, just as Millennio is. And one of the things that they do is they recognize their students at a Friday flag ceremony that they do at the end of the month. The names get drawn, and then the students get certificates, and they get their pictures up on the PBIS wall. So if you go to Niños, you'll see a lot of those targets, because they're talking a lot about targeting in on the positive behavior. There's Millennio again. Don't have to say much. So we talked a little bit about data-based decision-making. The big part of PBIS that's really important is to continuously monitor that data in the schools. It's not look at the data once, make some decisions, and then it's all done. The team is coming together to review the data consistently. And we have right now, we call them the big three. The three areas that we really want to focus on is location, time of day, and violation is what we're asking the schools to focus on as far as where they're going to put their efforts and make decisions. If it's the cafeteria, then they need to focus on the cafeteria. I just had a meeting with one of the schools, and they're finding bathroom needs to be reviewed again. So their PBIS team went to their staff and said, okay, we're going to focus on bathrooms for the next few weeks. So it's always based on data. So to wrap it up and to summarize a little bit, the three main areas that PBIS schools do is they maximize academic engagement and achievement of all students. PBIS schools are more engaging, more responsive, preventative, and productive. And they improve supports for students whose behaviors require more specialized assistance. Any questions?
Any questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item is 6.02, the whole reason I wore my sparkly shirt. Dr. Schauer, Academy of Boardsmanship Awards.
Thank you. This is what we've all been waiting for. And so it's my pleasure to present a few awards to our board members. And the first one is the Associate of Boardsmanship, and it's awarded for completing 60 hours in core curriculum areas. And that is going to Michelle Hirsch. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And then we have two other awards, and these are Certificate of Orientation, and they go to our two newest board members, Beth Brazell and Bernadette Coggins. So congratulations to both of you.
I just want to take a moment to say that I appreciate the award because it does take a lot of time to go to the extra workshops and conferences and trainings. And I'll say that when I first got on the board, it's almost 3 years now, that it was Ray Waters, a former board member, who said, take advantage of the trainings and professional development. It will make you a better board member. And there's always support from the district and the governing board for us to do that. And I appreciate that because I think it does make us better board members. Just to give the community an idea, we learn leadership and legal aspects and communications and board superintendent relationships and board operations, all kinds of things that go into making us really good board members. And even for those that didn't happen to get an award tonight, they've gotten awards before. And I can say that I believe this is one of the most involved, engaged governing boards I've ever heard of in Kyrene, and I've been in Kyrene for 18 or 19 years. So I want to applaud all of us, really, because we really work hard, whether it's here or before meetings or in trainings. So thank you. Let's applaud all of us. And an example of that is the next item, 6.03. We were calling this board briefings, but we renamed it to committee updates so that it gives us an opportunity to share with other board members some of the meetings we've attended and share that with other board members. And the first one is that I'll provide an update on the K-8 Programming Study Committee meeting that I recently attended last week. Was it last week? Thank you. And at that meeting, Dr. Taylor presented the special area study survey results. And in case you're not aware, special area teachers, all the special area teachers were surveyed, classroom teachers surveyed, and then principals as well. And it wasn't just a yes, no, fill in the dots kind of survey. They actually provided comments as to what's working, what's not, and suggestions for improvement. And all those comments, hundreds of comments, were compiled and presented to the K-8 committee for their review. And then my understanding is the next step, they will continue that discussion and look at some of the immediate fixes that can be put in place, and then maybe some fixes for, hopefully not maybe, some fixes for next year. And just to let everyone know that the K-8 Programming Study Committee meeting minutes are available on our website as well if you want to look at the whole thing. Are there any questions about that? Then next is Bernadette Coggins will provide an update on the Parent Superintendent Council meeting you attended.
Yay, and I even have the agenda in here. I was worried, where is that? but I would have remembered. It was a great PSC meeting. They did an update on The Taste of Kyrene, the book that they're reading, which I did not read that book, and maybe if you wanna, I didn't even write down what the title was. But I think the thing that I really loved was that at Millennio they have the Sunny Side Up character education show, and it was so cute. Did you bring some of your props so you could get up and dance for us? And the girls are going to come.
I thought that would be the hallway.
and really what they do is they've got these two gals that dress up, and they're the Sunshine Girls, and it's all about their pillars of character. So it's just basically a lot of the different schools have all their different flavors, and this is the Sunshine Girls, and they're just so cute, and they dress up, and they dance around, and they do funny skits, and it would be something that I think I would remember as I was growing up that they had that there. So it's a really great program. Then they talked about the current topic, which is the all-day kindergarten, and it was a great discussion. I think when you pull in PSC, you've got a lot of parents that they bring a very diverse you're bringing a diverse group together, so you're getting all of the questions asked. So you're not just getting one side, you're really getting folks that have been in the district for many years. So they say, okay, what are the repercussions? What are the benefits? So it's a real pro-con discussion, which I thought was very healthy. Let's see here. And the next future agenda items are going to be bullying, nutrition, wellness policy, but all in all, it was a really great PSC meeting.
That's a great update. Thank you, Ms. Coggins. And next is Ms. Brazell with an update on the Citizens Budget Committee meeting you attended.
I went to that last Tuesday. I only stayed for the first half, so I'll have to let you know that Jeremy had to be there for the second half, but I had to leave and it broke down to small groups. But Jeremy's the facilitator, and they started off discussing it, of course, that we had just found out that the override had actually passed, so everyone was happy about that. And we were able, and Kelly actually had the breakdown about where it all passed and all the different precincts and everything, so people were able to look at that if they wanted to. And the meeting was basically to do revenue generation. So there were two topics. One was the hiring of the new person in Kelly's area, or possible the comparison of that, or to have a contract person. And then to break down in small groups and discuss using of that land, that vacant land, like that Kelly was talking about too. And the groups were the four groups. And it's the same four groups that we had the meeting before for the all-day kindergarten. So we have four set groups to discuss best uses of that land. And I heard some of the comments afterwards of it, because I had asked one of the couple of people that were there what their groups talked about, but I didn't get the full recap of all four groups, because again, I left before that. But Jeremy is waiting for the recap from all four groups, and it's gonna be sending that out to everybody.
Thank you. And Without further ado, the next item is 6.04, budget update, and our interim CFO, Jeremy Callis, will update us on the current status of the budget, the work in progress, and the next steps.
Good evening once again, Madam President, Dr. Schauer, members of the board. Currently, we are in the process of analyzing our decisions from last year and analyzing the impact of those decisions, as well as analyzing our strategies for the upcoming year. A lot of that was shared earlier during the study session, and I understand that there may be some questions still lingering from the study session, so at your discretion, we could answer some of those questions now.
Are there any additional questions? Mr. Rupp?
I just want to talk a little bit about kind of a calendar and kind of get an idea of what kind of the budget schedule is here. You know, we chatted a little bit about, you know, that this kind of, I guess what I call this initial stage of budget discussion is really about, I think, the all-day kindergarten decision. And I guess maybe that's my first question for the group or for the board or for you, Jeremy, or you, David, or whoever, which is, you know, what are we looking for as a target date for a decision on all-day kindergarten? I know we've talked about, you know, historically it's been January, but there was some talk about trying to accelerate it. So what are we, at least in this initial stage, what do we think we're trying to do?
As we look at, you know, this whole plan, one of the things that drives these decisions, you know, this particular decision is enrollment, you know, and being able to share with our families what we're actually providing. So, you know, originally we said we wanted a decision before the winter break. I think if we had a decision in early January, you know, we'd be in pretty good shape. This is on, so, you know, I don't know why it's not working, but, oh, okay, a little closer. So anyway, now that's too loud, but, you know, and then as we look at any of these other issues, you know, if you talk about middle school schedules, some of the other ideas that were generated, those are decisions that have to be made that are contractual decisions about staffing, you know, so those decisions would come later in the spring. So what we wanted to do was to share as much information as we could up front, so as we make the decisions, we have all the information. So I hope that helps.
Right, so I guess the sense would be that even after the decisions are made on all-day kindergarten, that there really isn't going to be much of a lull period. We're probably going to be right back at it as it relates to trying to put some meat on the bone on this $5.2 million of stuff, which could be less depending on what happens with kindergarten. But
correct.
So is that pretty much the way we are seeing
it? And in the meantime, we'll continue to work with all of our different committees to further analyze and come up with the best decisions in all those different target areas that we've identified. And as you know, last year we didn't truly reach a final decision until May 31st. We would like to finish several, or at least a couple months prior to that this year, to give us ample time to issue those contracts and to be able to notify those who will be directly affected by the decisions that we make.
Right. Well, I think that, you know, in the past, there's kind of been the milestone dates have been the kindergarten date, the staffing date, and then, you know, depending on the year that we're talking about, there was always the sense of waiting for a number where, you know, we were had a pretty good sense of what the number was going to be. So, yeah, I think you're right that a lot of those budget line items that we're talking about are staffing-related things. So I think we'll probably be kind of in the same scenario as we were last year, where we're trying to make kind of April-ish kind of decisions, certainly related to anything that's staffing-related. So my sense is we're going to probably keep after it probably all through the beginning part of the year. Thank you.
Mrs. Sharma.
Do we have any more budget decisions to make for 2011?
For 2012, our current
year? No. Well, 11-12, yeah.
11-12. We have one item that is going to be presented under 8.02. Mm-hmm. 8.02. in regards to a one-time compensation adjustment, and that is for this current year.
But nothing that the state has told us that we're getting less money for?
No.
We know it won't be more or...
Typically, in the past, when the state has done mid-year reductions, they've done so by calling a special session, either in October or November timeframe, and then coming to the special session to address the fact that actuals are coming in below forecast.
Okay.
That's not the case this year. Not only have they not called for a special session, but the actuals are above forecast this
year. Okay. Thank you.
And then we're still all in agreement that we need the December 6th study session and meeting, as well as the December 13th study session, in order to get to the end of the year. Okay? And hopefully this addresses more than just my neighbor who cornered me this weekend and said he has no kids in Kyrene. So I'll preface by saying that, saying that the district needs to look at the budget and what we're reducing and what our expenses are. So, Glenn, I want you to pay attention to this meeting and the study session that this governing board and district is doing that. And I say that sincerely because I think that there may be people in our community that aren't aware of the number of study sessions, the number of stakeholder meetings, the number of committee meetings that are taking place in order to identify budget reductions and budget issues. So thank you, Jeremy. It only took me 2 hours to convince him that we're doing that. Item 7.01 is the consent agenda. May I have a motion to approve tonight's consent agenda?
I move to approve tonight's consent agenda.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next is 8.0 action items that are items for consideration, discussion, direction, and possible approval. And 8.01 is the first reading of policy CBA, qualifications and duties of the superintendent. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you. This item is one that we've been working on, as you all know, and reflects the suggested revisions. And so I believe that this is a final version, you know, with all the edits, and so that's why it's here as a first read. And I think a comment would be that this reflects more accurately what we believe the duties are, and so this isn't just about me, this is really about anyone that would be sitting in this chair. We believe that this policy would better serve us, so that's why we have it, and I want to thank you for your work on this and, you know, getting us to this point. So it's a first read.
And so I don't think we need to take a vote. It's just, we do need to vote on first read. One thing I want to add then before we do that is Nancy Hetrick reported to me, I'm not sure if you all heard, that ASBA reviewed this. And so I think they changed one word or suggested a change one word. And so the version has been reviewed by ASBA, and I thought you might like to know that. And they're fine with it.
Move to approve the first reading of board policy CBA.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next is item 8.02, compensation adjustment. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. Tonight we wanted to bring an item before you, related to what we were just talking about in terms of our budget. This is something that our employees, I think, have been waiting for quite a while. And it's not the end all, it's just a good faith gesture that we think is timely and important to act upon. And so I'll invite Jeremy to do a brief presentation on this, and then if you have any questions, we can answer them. So Jeremy.
Madam President, Dr. Schauer, members of the board, it's actually with great pleasure that I bring this item forward. I rarely get to present anything positive. I'm usually referred to as, I think I got Karen's old nickname of doom and gloom when I come into the room to make a presentation, so I'm glad to be bringing this item forward. First, when we talk about the compensation adjustment, we'll talk about why we're looking at doing a compensation adjustment in this current year. Under Kyrene's blueprint for success, we have for goal two, Kyrene School District will have the best and brightest staff members, and an objective to meet that goal is that retention of high-quality staff members will be a top priority. Yet due to budget constraints over the past 3 years, we've not been able to give raises. And additionally, employees have felt decreased take-home pay due to rising insurance and retirement costs. Let's talk about when we're targeting this compensation adjustment. When we worked with our payroll staff to identify a day, we had to take into account some of the other pays that are taking place during this time of year, not just our regular payroll days, but we have career ladder and classroom site fund performance pay that are paid out around this time of year as well. And so we identified December 15th as the optimal day for making this distribution. Talk about how we can afford this. During the study session, we expressed that we had increased budget balance carry forward. We also brought forward that we had additionally made plans for transferring funds from capital outlay revenue limit in the event that we needed it for additional teachers to stay within our ranges. Due to our increased staffing efficiencies, that need was never utilized. And we also had a contingency from M&O for four teachers. We only used one of those teachers. So we have those efficiencies, and also this would not all come from M&O. We would look at some other funds that could absorb some of the costs, such as our capital override. Now that it recently passed, we'll feel comfortable with staff who are currently funded out of capital override also getting this adjustment through capital override, and we'll look at other funds that may be able to do the same. Let's talk about who would be eligible. If approved by the board tonight, we would make eligible every employee that is currently in the Kyrene School District, with the exception of temporary employees, the superintendency, and executive directors. We would also require that they are still employed on December 15th when we make this disbursement. So let's talk about how much each employee would receive. For an employee working over 30 hours, it would be $500. For any employee working less than 30 hours, it would be prorated based on the number of hours worked, and that would be a proration on 30. So if you work 15 hours, you would receive $250. Aside from that, I can take any questions you have in regards to this one-time compensation adjustment.
I don't see board members on here. I'm just kidding. Mrs. Sharma?
We're going to double your pay.
Thank you. You are so generous, Jeremy.
Long as it's not doubling the work. thank you. I'm sure the teachers are going to appreciate it. And the rest of the staff also. I can't say enough thank yous because, as you stated, teachers have had at least a 15% decrease in pay between career ladder payouts, 301 payouts, and everything else. So, yes.
Mrs. Coggins?
You know, I just have to say, you know, I had some people say, well, if we're in such a deficit, how do we do this? And I spent a lot of time researching and creating some questions and sending emails out, and I would just like to say thank you for clarifying a lot of that for me, because, you know, there are questions with the M&O and the coral and what if this doesn't happen and this does. And, you know, at the end of the day, I'm kind of seeing how it's all just, you just kind of throw it up in the air, it seems like. But at least this will land in some deserving teachers' pockets. And so I just wanted to say that, you know, I did ask the tough questions, and I felt like the administration feels that they wouldn't have brought it forward to us if this was going to further impact us further into the black hole. So I'm feeling comfortable with this, and, you know, I wish we could do something a little more permanent, and hopefully maybe we can eventually, but for those that have been working so hard, and I see it in their faces when I stop by the schools, and the teachers have the circles, and especially with the little ones. And so anyways, I just wanted to say thanks for clarifying with me today, because I know I was really kind of all over trying to get a hold of everyone. So
any other comments, Mr. Robb?
I just actually have a question, Jeremy. What are we actually approving here? I'm actually trying to figure out what needed board approval here. Is it the use of the coral that we're approving, or I guess we are obviously all in favor. Well, I shouldn't say we're obviously we're going to vote on it, but I think everybody's in favor of it. But what are we actually being asked to do here?
It'll be a contract amendment that will have the compensation adjustment. The coral transfer will be approved when we bring the December 15th. I shouldn't be presumptuous to say will be approved, but will be brought forward during the December 15th revision when we ask for a coral transfer, and that would be in the amount of $560,000 would be bringing forward during the December 15th revision.
So this is actually a contract amendment or adjustment? Because I thought it was a stipend. It was just what it is.
I can defer to Dr. Knight in regards to what will be issued out.
Test. There we go. We've been working with our attorney, and we'll be actually be giving each employee who's eligible an amended contract that actually depicts exactly how much they'll be receiving. So it'll be $500 or a ratio depending on what their FTE is. So it's actually an amendment to the contract that you'll be approving tonight.
Okay. And I want to add one other thing. I agree with what you said, Ms. Coggins and Ms. Hashama, that for those in our community that may question this kind of vote or something brought forward like this at these times, we just cannot forget, and I know the people in this room don't forget it, but our community, extra amounts of money that teachers put out for supplies, the extra amounts of money that they are losing in career ladder and other aspects of their paycheck, and everyone is losing in the additional retirement amounts that they have to contribute. So I have never gotten the exact numbers, but I've heard things in hundreds and hundreds of dollars each month that teachers specifically are losing. So without having a raise in 3 years and experiencing those losses, and in addition to that, being asked to teach more classes and travel to more schools and have more responsibility and document more things. And so I just want our community to understand that this isn't frivolous and we are asking the tough questions. And we also trust the administration that you're bringing forward this with good planning. So thank you, Jeremy. Any other comments or questions? Then I'll ask for a motion.
Move to approve a $500 payment for employees.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Zero. Next is 8.03, approval of a delegate and an alternate delegate for the Arizona School Boards Association Delegate Assembly on December 15th. And we always have to push someone out to do this. let's see. I'm attending, Mrs. Coggins is attending, Mrs. Shama and Ms. Brazel is attending. So does anyone want to volunteer to be the delegate? Oh, you're wonderful. Ms. Brazel will volunteer to be the delegate, and does anyone want to volunteer to be the alternate delegate?
Mrs. Shama.
Oh, you will? Great. Miss, are we going to have a... Yeah. Did you want to? I'm just teasing you. Because we usually have to ask big people, yeah. So thank you, Ms. Brazel and Ms. Coggins. And
Move to approve.
Thank you.
Move to approve Beth as the delegate and Bernadette as the alternate.
All in favor, please. I need a second. And then all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Thank you. And then next is the information items in the 9-point section. And then we can move down to Item 10.0, items for future discussion. Does anyone have anything they'd like to add to items for future discussion? Mr. Robb.
I'd like to add use and process for the excess land.
Okay. And Ms. Coggins?
You know, I've just been working really closely with the high school lately, and there's some, and I don't see it on here, something to do with transitions, with foreign languages, with things that ultimately our kids need to get into a four-year university that I don't see, where I think we're gelling with Tempe Union or any other district. So I'd like to see some sort of transition.
Okay. And then I'd like to add a social media policy update, maybe what our policy is and what we're looking at updating that, given the Facebook pages and all the things that are new. And I'd also like us to, well, that's all I'll add for now. And then item 11.01 is meeting dates, and you can see the meeting dates. Hopefully we'll all enjoy the Thanksgiving holiday. And then a reminder that we have a December 6th meeting added with a 5:30 study session. And then Governing Board knows we have an executive session on December 9th and December 12th. And then next is item 12.01, Governing Board Reflections. Mr. Robb.
Well, with Thanksgiving coming, there's three things that I want to say. One is thank everybody for everything that they do, the board, fellow board members, administration, teachers, staff. Thank you to everybody for what they do. Second, happy Thanksgiving to everybody. And third, what was that third thing? Oops.
Oh, Mrs. Coggins.
Well, I think I've been telling my children all week, your attitude is gratitude, and everywhere you seem to turn, people are giving thanks for their blessings, and I just want to give thanks for my blessings and for wishing all of you to have a very wonderful, safe, happy Thanksgiving.
Ms. Brazell.
I want to kind of go back with what Ross said. I want to thank the administration and everyone for doing a lot of this work on the study sessions. I know it's taken a lot of your guys' time, and you're putting a lot of effort into this, and you're giving us a lot of the answers to the questions that we've been asking. And again, we're way ahead of the game than we were last year, so I really appreciate all the time you're putting into all this. And I want to thank everyone for doing that, and then wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving.
Gemma. Oops.
I want to remember that today, I don't know if anybody else is old enough to remember the 48th anniversary of the assassination of JFK. I also wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving and a restful Thanksgiving, if there's such a thing. And I also have some other things to say. At the last meeting, I got really excited about the coaches and stuff. And I'm not a political person insofar as I don't play both sides and try to appease both sides. Sitting up here, you know my positions. I don't hide them. I have a really strong compass for me on what's right and wrong. But I also realized that I had hurt the feelings of some of the coaches, and that was not my intent at all. So today, I spent half the day at Cheryl Green School at Esperanza with Debbie Ward, and I spent the other half of the day with Debbie Ward in her Murata position, and we did K-3 evaluations of the students. And it was an eye-opener. It really was how hard these people work. Now, my feeling when I was going through the whole thing is if we didn't have coaches, we'd have the money for raises, because I was not aware of everything Jeremy was doing to get the teachers raises. And one of my key objectives was I wanted to see them get some raises. But I really felt badly that I hurt feelings, all right? I never meant to denigrate their work. That was not my position, but that's how it was read to some of them, all right? And I just want to say, I am very passionate about children's education. And I just, for me, I know what's right. I don't speak for anybody else. I just speak for myself. And some of you will agree and some of you won't. But I would never put down the work of teachers. So I apologize for things I did. I value them. I saw the worth of the program, and I wish it was every place. And have a wonderful Thanksgiving.
Thank you, Mrs. Sharma. And I feel it's important to clarify that even though you might see my gray roots, I am not quite old enough to remember November 22nd, 1963, even though I was born. I like to mention when I am younger than some people. Makes me feel better. It doesn't happen all the time.
It catches up with you.
Want to just add, of course, thanks to everyone who's working hard in Kyrene. But for those of us who are blessed to enjoy Thanksgiving with our families and a good meal, I would just like to challenge you to maybe make a donation to the Kyrene Foundation or some other place in our community where families are not blessed by the abundance of food and family and joy that many of us experience. So if you are sitting down at Thanksgiving and enjoying that, maybe you've already given or donated. But if you haven't, I'd just like to challenge you to consider the foundation at kyrenefoundation.org and wish everyone a wonderful Thanksgiving holiday. Dr. Schauer.
I echo the best wishes to everyone for a nice time with family and loved ones. The thing I wanted to point out, it kind of fits with what you were just saying, is our Family Resource Center with community ed people today were passing out food baskets and hygiene bags in the parking lot. And I didn't get over there, but I heard about it. And so we do our best to take care of our own. And the need, as you know, as you can probably understand, is increasing. But we do our very best. So I want to congratulate everyone for making that happen. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Schauer. Now I need a motion to adjourn.
So moved. Second.
All in favor, please say aye. 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 Meeting adjourned at 8:35.